This evening on the Rock Newman Show, Dr. Lewis Sullivan is here to discuss his life growing up in the segregated South, establishing the Morehouse School of Medicine, and eventually becoming the Secretary of Health and Human Services under President George H.W. Bush. That's coming up right now on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Dr. Lewis Sullivan is the busiest man in medicine. He founded the Boston University Hematology Service, founded the Morehouse School of Medicine, served as the U.S. Secretary of Health and Human Services, hosted a television show, and is now working to eliminate racial disparities amongst healthcare workers. We are absolutely honored to have him here today. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us here.
My pleasure.
At the Rock Newman Show.
My pleasure.
You know, just recently we had on a guest. It was the chancellor of the DC public school systems, and mm-hmm. she sat there and she was just so radiantly beautiful. So I did something that is probably politically incorrect. On television, you know, they say you're not supposed to objectify a woman, but I told her how wonderfully beautiful she was. Okay, right. You're beautiful also. I am inspired by looking at you and having you come in here and sit down where I want to lose an additional 30 pounds or so. And when I do, I want that tie, I want that shirt, right. I want that suit, the belt, and your pocket. You are clean. You're clean, Dr. Sullivan.
Well, when you lose that 30 pounds, call me.
I'm going to do it.
You got it.
I'm gonna do it. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you.
In the foreword to your book, Breaking Ground, how, if ever a book was appropriately titled, this book is appropriately titled, Breaking Ground. In the foreword, Andy Young talks about a Dr. Joseph Griffin. Now, I've been one that have paid a lot of attention to people speaking their lives into existence, good or bad. And when you were 5 years old or somewhere thereabouts, you said, I want to be like Dr. Joseph Griffin. He lived 40 miles away from where you grew up.
Right.
And he came and he was the doctor that took care of people.
Exactly.
You said, I want to be like him.
Yes, that's correct, because I was born in Atlanta, but by the time I was age two, my father had moved the family to rural Southwest Georgia, Blakely, to establish the first black funeral home there. Mm-hmm. There was no black doctor in Southwest Georgia except for Dr. Griffin in Bainbridge, which was 41 miles south. And my parents, like so many blacks in those years, this is back in the 30s and 40s, rather than the indignity of going in a separate door, usually in the back of a building, mm-hmm. to see a white doctor, mm-hmm. they would drive 41 miles south to see Dr. Griffin. So my father would take people there because he operated an ambulance service, mm-hmm. and I would frequently go with him.
Yeah.
Dr. Griffin was someone I thought was magical.
Yeah.
Because he had the power to cure people,
yeah.
to help them.
Yeah.
He was highly respected.
Yeah.
When you had opened the door to his clinic, which was a brick building, unusual in that time,
mm-hmm.
you would get the pungent smell of ether.
Yeah.
He'd be in his green scrub suits. And he just was someone who had a capability no one else had. He was highly respected.
Yeah.
And I said, that is what I want to be.
He was your Superman.
Absolutely. He was my hero. Right.
Yeah. You know, I am going to do something that I typically don't do with this show. I've thought about the multiple ways we might be able to try to unwrap your illustrious career and your journey. And I really came back to perhaps the best way to do it is to introduce people in a real way to your fascinating book. Because better than I ever could in an interview, this here is a document. It is a publication that is illuminating, that is inspiring, that is educational. And it is something that, it is a book, your journey is a journey that is now encapsulated in this book. And I just think that if those who are watching would pick this book up, we're not here to sell books at all, we're here to share information and to inspire you. But if you pick this book up, Breaking Ground, by Dr. Lewis W. Sullivan, and if you read it, as Sylvester the singer once said, your foot will have to be, your ear would have to be in your foot if you can't hear the loud and wonderful message in this book. Let's start.
Fine.
Good. Chapter one. First of all, your friend Andy Young wrote, yes, wrote the foreword.
Yes. Andy, of course, is a great leader, great person. When I went back, I was born in Atlanta, but years later, I was professor of medicine at Boston University when I was recruited back to Atlanta to start the Morehouse School of Medicine. Andy was a member of Congress, yeah, at that time. That's when I first met him. And he was very helpful to us in developing the medical school. So we developed a great relationship to this day. And so I'm honored that he wrote the foreword for the book.
You know, that is such a classic example. And, you know, I'll go to your chapters, mm-hmm, but I'll step outside from time, right, to time also. When I became aware of Andy Young's influence in your life, it was such a classic example of it really does take a village. Mm-hmm. None of our journeys are, mm-hmm, ours alone.
Exactly.
And a relationship with an Andy Young, who, mm-hmm, sat in Congress during a time that you were establishing an initiative that was very important to Morehouse College and became, mm-hmm, very important to the nation. Mm-hmm. You had an ally that helped carry the ball for you there.
Absolutely. He was invaluable. He brought me to Washington, meet members of Congress, urged financial support for the medical school. And so he was of such stature that he gave us credibility because this was a new venture. People wondered, is this really going to go anywhere? Is it wise, et cetera? So having people like Andy Young really in our corner and working, not simply giving us really explanation points, but really working hard, yeah, to help us succeed. That was very important.
Yeah. Okay, let's go. Chapter one is Blakey, Georgia. Talk, mm-hmm, to us about Blakey, Georgia and that childhood.
Well, that was really an interesting time. My father established the first black funeral home in Blakely. Mm-hmm. He had been a life insurance salesman for Atlanta Life Insurance Company in Atlanta, but this was during the Depression. He was going broke, not selling insurance. No one was buying insurance at that time. They were trying to pay the rent or put food on the table. So he moved to Blakely to establish the first black funeral home there. But he's also an activist. He started a chapter of the NAACP. He fought to get blacks the right to vote. There was a white primary in Georgia at, sure, that time. Yeah. He established an annual Emancipation Day celebration, January 1st of every year. We get speakers like John Wesley Dobbs, Maynard Jackson's grandfather, Thurgood Marshall, and others to come down Emancipation Day. He sued the school system to really say these facilities were not equal. They were separate, but certainly not equal. So he was an activist. My mother was a school teacher.
Let's stay with him for just a second, because I said just a moment ago that Dr. Joseph Griffin was your superman.
Yes.
For your dad to undertake the kind of activism that he took, and this was
1935, he moved to Blakely,
yeah,
right.
1935, before moving into the World War, Blakely, Georgia,
yes,
Southern Confederacy.
Oh, yes. Yes.
For your father, mm-hmm, to take the initiative, mm-hmm, to be on the forefront of change at that time, that,
yes,
must have been a source of courage and power and inspiration for you that is unspeakable.
It was high risk. Lynchings were still occurring at that time. Because of my father's activism, my mother, the 20 years they lived there, never got a job teaching school in Blakely. That was the white community's way of trying to retaliate. They couldn't hurt my father because he was serving the black community.
Yeah.
So he was a man of great courage. He was only 5'5".
Yeah.
But he really did a lot. And he and my mother were so committed to my brother, who's a year and a half older than me, they were so committed to us getting the education, they sent us away to Savannah when I was in fifth grade, my brother's in sixth grade, mm-hmm. and then to Atlanta to attend schools, because schools for blacks were so poor yeah. In those times. Yeah. So now he was a real activist, looking back on this now, I have nothing but tremendous admiration for both of my parents, what they did.
Let me ask, staying with your father for a moment still. Was there one overriding theme that came out of your looking up to that 5'5" giant?
Oh yes, that is, never let anyone define you. That is, he said, I have the equal rights to anyone else, yeah. and I'm not going to let you circumscribe me. Yeah. So that really was...
Never let anyone else define you.
Yeah, right. And that was the message he was trying to share with members of the black community. And he had friends in the yeah. black community. The Klan was active then. Yeah. Many times they were threatened, would get word they were going to riot through the black community. My father would go down to the police station mm-hmm. to say he'd heard that, and he didn't know if the policeman knew anything about it, but if he knew anything, just tell them that they'd be there waiting.
Yeah, hello.
They'd never show up.
Wow.
Right. So he was, he really was a man of great courage, and in fact, there was an effort to kill him. Yeah. He was wounded by a man hired to shoot him. He survived, but he never left.
You know what? At the risk of folks writing and saying, hey, you know, this is an interview you're supposed to be doing, not a soapbox. I'm gonna take the soapbox just for a second and say to my viewers, hear what Dr. Sullivan is talking about in 1935 and 1940, the Klan coming through and him being committed to a change. And you juxtapose that against some of our conditions today. It's never to minimize anyone's plight. Mm-hmm. But when our forefathers have overcome what your dad overcame with mm-hmm. courage and strength and intellect and commitment to making this world a better place, mm-hmm. where we stand today, mm-hmm. we don't have a lot to complain about. We'll keep going.
Yes. So, great courage, great integrity. And he was doing this not only for himself,
yeah.
but for the community.
Yeah, yeah. Your mother was a school teacher. Was educated,
right.
A school teacher, couldn't get a job.
Right.
What's the great memory of mom?
Well, during the 20 years they lived there, she taught in other towns outside yeah. of that county.
Yeah.
So she would drive from 14 miles to as far as 40 miles away during the time she was there. She was a great teacher. She had a master's in education from Atlanta University. Mm-hmm. She became a gene supervisor, so there was no question that she was well qualified, but this was pure political retaliation. Mm-hmm. So my folks and their friends, they really lived in a world, they supported each other, they were very strongly committed to the fact that their children will have a better life than they had.
Yeah.
And that's why they did the things that they did for my brother and myself. So whatever I've accomplished, I have to attribute that to my parents, what they did, and the standard and the example that they set for me.
You stand on some very broad, strong shoulders. Yeah. So they sent you to Savannah, sent you and your brother.
Yes.
To Savannah.
Right.
Tell us about that experience.
That was interesting because Blakely at that time was a small town of around 7,000-8,000 people, so Savannah was a big city. Lived with my grandfather and my aunts, and this was the first time I really ran into segregation right up front because
overt.
Yes.
Yeah.
My grandfather was taking us, I think, to the movies, and we got on the bus, and I was in front of him, so I got on the bus and I sat down. And my grandfather put the money in the bus receptacle there.
And this is what year?
This is now about 1945.
45.
Thereabouts, yes.
Mm-hmm.
My grandfather came over and pulled me and back to the back, and I didn't know what was happening.
Yeah.
And I was surprised, and then he said, no, you sit back here.
And then you were how old?
Oh, I was then, I would have been 9 years old.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So he then explained to me that blacks sat in the back of the bus.
Yeah.
And I wondered why. He said, well, that's the way it is.
Mm-hmm.
And so I really, that's when I really learned, because of course there was no public transportation in Blakely, there's too small a city. So my grandfather was a loving person, as well as my aunts, but we had a great time in school. The teachers were very dedicated, but we really began to learn something about the outside world. So we enjoyed Savannah. It's a great city, still is a great city. But the following year, my mother went to Atlanta to get her master's degree at Atlanta University, and we went with her, and we enrolled in school there. And by the end of that year, she had arranged with a friend to take us in as boarding students so that we could attend schools there in Atlanta. So I graduated from Booker Washington High School in Atlanta in 1950 as a result of that. So we would go home to Blakely on holidays, some occasional weekends, but primarily to see that we would get as good an education as possible, we attended schools in Atlanta.
Let me ask you something about that moment when your granddad snatched you up and you came face to face with the reality that in essence, that African Americans, the colored at the time, Negro, whichever the name was, were second-class citizens. I remember being in a Catholic church and recognizing, this was really weird, so out in rural Southern Maryland, that white people sat in the front, light-skinned people sat in the middle, and dark-skinned people sat in the back. And I went up one time and sat, like there was a row of pews that was off to the right of the altar in front of everybody. So one day when my mom was reading the Weekly Standard, I ran, I went up there, and she came and snatched me. And later we talked about it. I remember the feeling that I had of really, I think it was a cross between hurt feelings and a loss of innocence. When you go back to that moment, do you remember how that felt?
Oh yes, I was totally surprised. I didn't know what had happened. I thought I'd done something wrong. And my grandfather, in this haste to get us away from there, didn't explain until he sat us down in the back. And then he said, no, you sit here. I said, why? He said, well, that's just the way it is. Yeah. He didn't want to engage me at that time. And so I was confused, and I was embarrassed too, because to these people who were on the bus, I'd done something and I didn't quite understand. So that really was a moment I still remember to this day. Then I later explained and told my aunts when we got home, and that's when they explained, on the bus, blacks sit in the back. So that was really quite a...
When you heard that, when you heard blacks sit in the back, what was your mindset about that? Was it something you knew you had to endure to sort of keep the peace? Was there a rebellious streak in you that wanted to do something about that?
Oh, there was a rebellious streak, yes. But when my grandfather said something, we really accepted that as law.
Sure.
But I, you know, I asked them, why is that? And that, they just say, well, that's the way it is, and you must do that. So really it was clear to me that this is what we expect of you, and don't challenge us, don't ask for an explanation, but that's just the way it is. So it was really kind of not a satisfying experience. This is something where I wanted to know, why was it this way? And there, I didn't get a good explanation, but I was told this is what you have to do.
You point something out, and again, I would juxtapose that with some of what we see today. You said you had your thought about it, but you really didn't at that time, you didn't question what your grandfather said. There was a very clear authority figure.
Yes.
And if we had a greater preponderance of that kind of authority in our households today, what a different world we would live in.
Oh yes, yes, right. You know, we loved him, we respected him. I didn't quite know why that was the way I had to react, but I had enough regard for him that I simply followed him.
Yeah, okay. Chapter 2, Morehouse College.
Right.
Tell us about the Morehouse experience.
great experience. When I was about to graduate from high school, I told my parents that I wanted to go to Morehouse. Yeah. This was a surprise because my mother had gone to Clark, and my brother, who was a year ahead of me, had gone to Clark also, and mm-hmm. we were a Methodist family.
Yeah.
So when I told my parents I wanted to go to Morehouse, they were surprised.
Yeah.
Why is that? Because we are a Methodist family, and Morehouse is a Baptist school.
Yeah.
And I said, well, gosh, that was the way when they were founded, but they are no longer really part of those churches. There's maybe some tradition. Mm-hmm. So my father was not happy about this. And I said, well, Dad, you know, I'm not going to church. I'm going to school. Yeah. And of course, my friends were going to Morehouse, and I also knew Morehouse had an excellent reputation, particularly in the sciences. So my mother, this was over dinner, my mother intervened, and she said, Walt, that's fine. Morehouse is a good school, so if he wants to go there, yeah. he'll do fine. So that was the end of it. So she served as the peacemaker. Then going to Morehouse was tremendous because we had great leadership there, starting with Benjamin Mays, the president. And I can tell you that every student there, including me, wanted to be like Dr. Mays. He was elegant. He was really very articulate.
Yeah.
He was spellbinding.
Yeah.
He had high standards. Yeah. And he exacted the same standards of himself as he exacted of the students. Mm-hmm. So, and we knew that he was well respected. He was always off someplace giving speeches.
Yeah.
Et cetera. And he, as you know, was a counselor to Martin Luther King Jr., our most famous Morehouse graduate. So he set a high standard for the school. And he would have sayings such as, whatever you choose to do in life, you should do it so well that no man living, no man dead, or no man yet to be could do it better.
Yeah.
He said, if you commit yourself to that, when they're looking for someone in your field, they will have to consider you.
Yeah.
So you may not get the position, but it should not be because you're not qualified. So what he was telling us, really think of yourself at the top. You want to aspire to be the best. And what he was also saying, certainly life is not fair and there's discrimination, et cetera, but you shouldn't lose an opportunity because you're not qualified. The other teachers there at the
Hold on, before you go to the other teachers, because I want to share something. Chris Matthews, the host for MSNBC, mm-hmm. he talked about seeing the moment when Barack Obama was declaring victory as mm-hmm. the president of the United States. Mm-hmm. And he set himself up for a lot of criticism, saying that he got a tingle going up his leg. And, you know, the other media mm-hmm. people, you're supposed to be dispatched and objective, and you're just mm-hmm. not supposed to have that kind of human feeling.
Right.
While you were talking about Benjamin Mays, mm-hmm. went all up and down, what a giant.
Yep.
What a giant.
Right. Right. So he was another role model, because in the same way that Dr. Griffin had a profound impact upon me, Dr. Mays also, because Dr. Griffin I admired for his professional skills and his personal interactions with his patients. Dr. Mays was a national person, mm-hmm. and we knew about his history.
Yeah.
He had gone to Bates College, the only black in his class, had hitchhiked to get there.
Yeah.
Finished as valedictorian in his class.
So. Right.
So he was someone who set a high standard, and we wanted to be just like him. He would challenge us, and we wanted to respond to that challenge. The people he recruited for the faculty, they were equally committed.
Yeah.
And so the Morehouse environment for me was a very rich environment. My classmates, they were friends, but we competed.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I had finished as salutatorian in my class at Booker Washington High, but one of my classmates, Vic Saunders from Vicksburg, Mississippi, had finished as valedictorian at his class.
Yeah.
Other friends from Memphis, same thing. So
sure.
here were all
sure.
these
yeah,
guys
yeah.
who were very bright.
Yeah.
So this really was a very rich environment where we enjoyed competing.
Where were you in relationship to while you were there and Martin Luther King came in?
He was ahead of me.
Uh-huh.
He finished Morehouse in 1948. I entered in 50.
Uh-huh. Right. Okay.
So we didn't overlap.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
So this was really a rich environment, and of course we knew about other Morehouse graduates who had gone on to really distinguish themselves. So the 4 years I was there were very important years. I grew tremendously, both in knowledge as well as in professional activities. So we were really oriented to really go out and challenge the world.
And so the mindset you developed at 5 years old, where you wanted to be like Dr. Joseph Griffin, that remained. You never wavered from that. You had your head down.
Wanted to be a doctor. I enjoyed nature, mm-hmm. botany, mm-hmm. Et cetera. Mm-hmm. I'd be interested in animals, mm-hmm. or interested in trees or flowers, et cetera. So, no, I had all of that. But my goal was to really become a doctor so I could help people.
So you're at Morehouse, you want to be a doctor, you're dealing with botany and flowers and plants and animals.
Right.
What, if any, impact did a guy out of Tuskegee named Booker T. Washington have on you?
Well, we admired Booker Washington, mm-hmm. but we also had the image of W.B. Du Bois. Mm-hmm. We were very familiar with the W.B. Du Bois, Booker Washington debate,
sure.
as to what is the proper education, you know, for the Negro. Mm-hmm. And of course, being at Morehouse, we were more inclined to Du Bois,
yeah.
the life building a career and life of the mind, mm-hmm. skills. Mm-hmm. Whereas we admired Booker Washington because we felt that certainly there's a place for skills and crafts and so forth. But we admired W.B. Du Bois, and of course Mays was right in that same tradition.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You know what can happen. What can happen is we have an hour to do this show, and we could talk for 6 hours. So let's move. Morehouse, then you're a medical student.
Right. That was an interesting thing that happened because during my junior year at Morehouse, we always had these career counseling weeks for all of the students. And for the pre-medical students, we had sessions, and we had people from the Urban League and the NAACP come by. And so we were encouraged to apply to Howard and Meharry, mm-hmm. but don't be limited. Say, apply all over. So you really ought to be able to go wherever you want.
Sure.
So my class, graduating class from Morehouse in 1954, was a total of 59 students.
Mm-hmm.
College is much bigger now.
Yeah.
But of those 59 students, there were 19 pre-medical students. 18 of us went off to medical school. Mm-hmm. The 19th went to dental school.
Yeah.
So all of the pre-med students got into medical school. That was really the quality of the education that we got there.
Yeah.
I went to Boston University. I had not thought of applying elsewhere until we had those career counseling sessions.
Mm-hmm.
So I applied to Boston University, University of Michigan, University of Rochester, and was accepted by all. But mm-hmm. Boston University was the first to offer me the position, so I accepted there.
Mm-hmm.
When I sent in my application, about 3 weeks later, I received a letter asking if I could make an appointment for an interview with the local physician in Atlanta, who was a Boston University graduate. So I went downtown, white physician, and I thought this was primarily to hear more about the school. We had what I considered not a very satisfactory interviewed. I didn't think he seemed interested.
Mm-hmm.
So I left the thing hoping that I got past the screening so that I would be invited to the medical school in Boston for the real interview.
Yeah.
Well, I got a letter about 2 weeks later, and I was nervous when I got it, because would this be inviting me to BU, or would it be a letter of rejection?
Mm-hmm.
I opened the letter. It said, "Congratulations. We're pleased to offer you a position in the first year class at Boston University." I hadn't been to Boston.
Yeah.
So I was very surprised.
Sure.
That I was, I ran over to Dr. Burney's office. He was the chairman of biology, great teacher, to tell him. And he was very pleased too, because I was one of Burney's boys.
Mm-hmm.
So when I went to Boston in September of 1954, that was my first time in a non-segregated environment.
Okay.
I was the one black student in my class of 76, and I had wondered, how am I going to be accepted here?
Mm-hmm.
Make a long story short, I was well accepted. I had tremendous experiences with my classmates. I was class president my second and third years, and I finished as one of the top students in the class. And I really had a tremendous experience, both professionally and socially, in Boston. Boston, of course, is a historical city. Paul Revere and his ride, the Boston Tea Party,
mm-hmm.
The fights in Lincoln, in Lexington, in Concord, et cetera. And I soaked all of that up. Crispus Attucks, the first black to die in the Revolutionary War, mm-hmm. the statue of him on the Boston Commons there. So that, for me, was a very rich experience, and I enjoyed it thoroughly.
And I'm really surprised for you to talk about it and to explain it that way. I visited Boston in 1972, and my girlfriend at the time was a very dark-skinned girl. Mm-hmm. And those that were there in Boston in the mm-hmm. diner that I was in having dinner after a Jesse Jackson speech, as a matter of fact, thought that it was a white guy with a black girl. Mm-hmm. And man, I didn't know if I was gonna get out of there alive. So I was gonna mm-hmm. ask you,
yep.
what the experience, you said it was non-segregated, right. but I was gonna ask you to sort of juxtapose sure. the South that you had come out of, very segregated, right. going to Boston, what you felt about
sure.
that.
Sure, right. Well, several things. First, there was a major shift in Boston that occurred in the late 50s after I'd been in Boston several years. That was Louise Day Hicks, mm-hmm. the busing controversy.
Yeah.
She was a member of the city council,
yeah.
and she led the effort opposed to busing for integration. Mm-hmm. So the environment changed dramatically mm-hmm. After I'd been in Boston.
Because
when I went there in 54,
yeah.
I found this to be a very open environment, and I enjoyed it. But it was not perfect, because later, after I got married and we were looking for a place to stay in the early 60s,
yeah.
I ran into segregation, it ran into discrimination. It was hidden. Mm-hmm. That is, with a name like Sullivan in Boston, yeah. that's yeah. the most common name in
sure.
the Boston telephone yeah. book.
Right.
So I'd call up saying, this is Dr. Sullivan, yeah. you have a place for it? They say, well, come on by, doctor.
Sure.
And I get there and say, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't know that my sister had rented this just yeah. a few minutes.
Right.
So there were problems there. But the polarization that occurred in Boston, that was in the late 50s.
Mm-hmm.
And I've talked with a number of friends and students who've gone to Boston in the 60s who mm-hmm. really had a very different view of the city than what
That's
I had.
That's very interesting, that there was a period of time where you felt like, and I'll just say it this way, that racial tensions were not as nearly as heightened during mm-hmm. those 50s as
right.
after the busing controversy,
yes.
that they became much greater
oh, yes.
later on.
Oh, yes.
And I compare and contrast that to something that I say that, you know, I graduated high school in the 70s, came here to Howard University, 70-74, and this is all right after the height of the Civil Rights Movement, and there was that sense of optimism about racial relations and the mm-hmm. seeming of things getting better. And that right. happened, what I think lasted maybe 30 plus years.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel a continuing sense now that like positions hardened, as you're saying there in Boston, mm-hmm. in the late 50s, early 60s, as opposed mm-hmm. to how it was 8 years earlier, six, 8 years earlier, mm-hmm. that we feel some of that now.
Yes.
Well, sir, I want to come right back to the book.
Right.
But do you feel what I'm talking about at all?
Oh, yes, yes, no question about it. And really, I think the situation in Boston really was a contrast to what was going on elsewhere in the country. But Louise Day Hicks was a politician who used this effort to try and get elected mayor. And so that really changed in the environment there. But the civil rights movement, from my perspective, played a very important role, not only in terms of getting blacks the right to vote and the legislation, voter rights bills, et cetera, but also opened the eyes of the nation to all of these things that were happening. So that I think was very clear. There were two major factors that contributed to the development of the Morehouse School of Medicine. One was the civil rights movement.
Mm-hmm.
People learned that there's such a shortage of black doctors and other health professionals. Then the other major force was the fact that the United States committed to expanding medical education in the mid-50s.
Mm-hmm.
In 1950, we had 80 medical schools in the country, graduating some 8,000 physicians. But beginning in the mid-50s, there were funds from the Department of Health and Human Services, the Veterans Administration, and the Department of Defense to support new schools. So those funds really made it possible to develop Morehouse School of Medicine, along with the opening of the eyes of the nation to the shortage, so that we then were able to have people like Andy Young and also Lou Stokes in the Congress and others really help us get the funding for that.
When did you first get the seed of thought that there could be a Morehouse School of Medicine and perhaps you'd be the founding dean?
Well, that was, first of all, that was a dynamic time. Mm-hmm. Because clearly the civil rights activities in the late 50s and 60s, et cetera. I was in Boston when Carter was running for president, and I remember the peanut brigades, mm-hmm. people like John Lewis and Andy Young and other blacks from Georgia going around the country saying this peanut farmer Carter is a good person and so forth. So very clear the influence that the Atlanta black community or the Georgia black community had on black communities around the nation. So I knew that, and having been born in Atlanta and knowing the Atlanta University Center, this was really a great center and great resource. When Morehouse College looked at the idea of a medical school, this is because the state health department had done a study showing that while 28% of Georgians were African American back in the late 60s, only 2% of the physicians in Georgia were African American. Plus, Georgia overall had a shortage of physicians. Mm-hmm. So that was a rational basis for trying to develop medical school. Mm-hmm. Because of the civil rights activities, blacks are now voting. Mm-hmm. When Morehouse was looking at this, we now had Herman Talmadge as our senior senator, mm-hmm. And Sam Nunn was a junior senator. Mm-hmm. Herman Talmadge's father, Eugene Talmadge, I knew of very well when I was growing up. Mm-hmm. He made his career on segregation.
Yeah.
But because of the fact that blacks are now registering to vote, Herman Talmadge wanted to create his own image.
Yeah.
He was very supportive of the Morehouse School of Medicine.
Yeah.
He was chairman of the Agriculture Committee in the Senate, and not having anything to do with health, but he could trade a lot of favors mm-hmm. with other members of Congress mm-hmm. who needed some action through his committee. Mm-hmm. So, and Andy Young took me to lunch that time when I first came to Washington, took me over to Herman Talmadge. We had lunch in the Senate dining room with Andy Young, Herman Talmadge, and Sam Nunn, and that's when we got the commitment from him to be supportive. And I was very much aware that this was because he knew of the political power of the black community and he wanted to change his image. And this was one way he could do it.
Oh, how some votes can cause a change of heart.
Yes.
Oh, how some football players at Alabama could change Bear Bryant's heart.
Exactly, exactly.
Okay.
That's why I say that the development of Morehouse School of Medicine benefited directly from the civil rights activities.
So, you go through the process, you get it established, you're the founding dean, Morehouse School of Medicine is having enormous impact. And then somebody named George Herbert Walker Bush mm-hmm. places a call. Tell us about that moment.
Right. Well, again, there's some events that led up to that. We had the help from Andy Young and Louis Stokes and Doe Clay and other members of Congress and our two senators, we'd gotten support for the school. We had our first building under construction when President Carter, who had been very helpful too, he lost to Reagan in his election. We didn't know anyone in the Republican Party. So we sent a letter in January of 81, shortly after Reagan assumed office, inviting him to come speak at Morehouse School of Medicine at the dedication of this building we had under construction, which was scheduled to be completed in December of 81.
Invited Reagan.
Yes, uh-huh. right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Then Reagan sends his education budget to the Congress in March of that year, but he cut the education budget. We were surprised.
Yeah.
We were concerned. Mm-hmm. Oh, well, we're still waiting. But then in August of 81, there was a Bob Jones University controversy in South Carolina where they had this rule prohibiting interracial dating.
Yeah.
And remember, Reagan endorsed Bob Jones.
Yes.
So here we have this invitation out to him. And now by this time, I'm saying, I hope he turns us down.
Yeah.
Because I said, if someone with values like this, how could we really justify this? So mm-hmm. make a long story short, finally around October, we got a letter, the president couldn't come.
Mm-hmm.
I was relieved.
Hallelujah.
But my advisor said, wait, don't let them off like that. send a letter saying, nicely, but how could you hold us up for all this time? And then say the president can come. Please see if the vice president can come.
Okay.
We tried it and it worked.
Yeah.
The building construction schedule slipped, so we actually dedicated that building not in December of 81, but in July of 82.
Okay.
With Vice President George Herbert Walker Bush. Mm-hmm. He was there. He was supposed to stay only 15 minutes after the program because he was supposed to fly off to New Orleans, but he stayed more than an hour. And again, Andy Young, Ed McIntyre, the black mayor of Augusta, John Lewis, Congressman Scott, and a number of others were there, all getting their pictures taken with Vice President Bush. Mm-hmm. So he finally left, and one of his aides pressed something into my hand, said, the Vice President wants you to have these. And he left, I looked through a pair of Vice Presidential cufflinks.
Mm-hmm.
2 weeks after his visit, I got a call on a Friday afternoon. I was trying to finish some work in my office, and my secretary says, the Vice President's on the line. I said, what Vice President? She says, how quickly we forget. I said, oh, that Vice President.
Yeah.
He was on the line. He said, Lou, he was planning a trip to Sub-Saharan Africa in November of that year. Now, this was July.
Mm-hmm.
And wanted to invite me to be part of his delegation. I said, well, gosh, Mr. Vice President, I'd be honored, and I think I could arrange my schedule here, but since I'm not in government, what would my role be as a member of your delegation?
Right.
He said, well, Lou, to be honest with you, this will be the first visit to Sub-Saharan Africa of a senior member of the Reagan administration, and I can't go to Africa without some prominent African-Americans in my delegation,
mm-hmm.
he said. And we don't have an Andy Young in our administration, so you would do me a favor, but more importantly, you'd do the country a service if you'd be willing to go.
Hmm.
I appreciated his honesty, so yeah. I said, well, let me see if I can work my schedule, et cetera, and I was able to do it. On that trip in November, for 2 weeks, visiting 8 countries, while Bush was meeting with heads of state, people like Mugabe, who was newly in office, sure. at that time was a hero,
yeah,
who
absolutely.
Led the resistance.
Yeah.
And while Bush was meeting with heads of state, Barbara was talking to adult literacy groups, usually women's groups.
Mm-hmm.
And I would go along to her events. She dedicated the Belvedere College, a new college in Harare, Zimbabwe, built with USAID funds. So I was very impressed by what she was doing. So on the way back, I said, Barbara, you and I are in the same business. You're in adult education, I'm in medical education. We are a new school, we need someone like you. Would you be willing to serve on our board?
Mm-hmm.
So she said, well, Louis, you know, before I accept anything like this, I have to check with the White House counsel,
yeah.
so let me get back to you.
Uh-huh.
I thought that was the end of it. We got back the day before Thanksgiving there in 1982. She called me the following Tuesday. She said, Lou, I can do it. She came on our board. And that's when I really got to know the Bushes very well, because then my wife and I were frequently invited to things here at the Vice President's home.
Mm-hmm.
I learned such things as the fact that Herbert Walker Bush's mother was one of the founding directors of the United Negro College Fund.
Okay.
Secondly, Bush himself has a strong commitment to black educational institutions. He spoke, for example, at the dedication, at the inauguration of Ben Payton as president of Tuskegee, actually in October of 81. And by the way, Ben was on that trip also in November of 82.
Mm-hmm.
I would always get a check in the mail unsolicited, just with a quick note, from personal funds, their own contribution to Morehouse School of Medicine.
Mm-hmm.
So at any rate, when he was running for president, we'd gotten to know him so well and I admired him. I said, we'd like to have a reception at my home for you to introduce you to the black community.
Mm-hmm.
Because I said, you know, the black community really doesn't know you. To be honest, their view of the Reagan administration isn't as positive as I think it should be, so I'd like to do this. So he agreed. We had this reception. He couldn't come, but Barbara was there.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, when that happened, all my friends said, well, we know this means you're going to be going to Washington. I said, no. One of my trustees, whom I admired very much, desperately wanted to be secretary. He had been a finalist in 1985 when Otis Boyne was selected. So I told my trustee, well, if Bush gets it, I'll certainly support you. So to make a long story short, I sent his resume to the vice president and said, if you win, I think you ought to look at this resume. He'd be a great secretary of HHS. You've met him, Barbara knows him, et cetera. After the election, I called to congratulate him on the election. I said, now remember we talked about Monroe. I hope you take a close look at it. So he said, well, Lou, I've looked at that, and you know, that looks fine, but if you're willing, I'd like to talk to you about this. So if you'd be willing to come up to Washington in 2 or 3 weeks after things have settled down, we need to talk. Yeah. I said, fine. And I hung up, and I wasn't sure. I said, now, did I hear right? Sounds to me like he wants to talk to me rather than talk about Monroe.
Right.
And sure enough, that's how it happened.
Amazing. You just mentioned something, and I don't think we can't talk about your life without hearing you weigh in on this, where you said that you wanted to introduce some of the black folks in the Atlanta area to George W. Bush. Your sense was they didn't have an appreciation for who Reagan was or for who Bush was.
For Bush, not Reagan.
Okay.
I never forgave Reagan for cutting that education budget, mm-hmm. and I couldn't ignore
some of the states' rights stuff.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. I was wondering about that, yeah. And I was also wondering about your political affiliation at mm-hmm. that time.
Sure.
Were you declared one way or the other at that time?
Yes. I was not politically active, but I was Republican.
Mm-hmm.
My father was a Republican
uh-huh.
because in my father's generation,
yeah.
he identified with Lincoln.
Sure.
He had freed the slaves.
Sure.
Those people my father was suing in Blakely, they were Democrats. Mm-hmm. There was no Republican Party mm-hmm. in Georgia mm-hmm. back in the 30s mm-hmm. and 40s.
Yeah.
So that was natural. And the only political argument I had with my father was during the 1960 elections when I told him I was going to vote for Kennedy
yeah.
and not Nixon.
Yeah.
So I was Republican, but I wasn't active and I wasn't.
See, and, yeah. and I think that speaks to people's tendency to so quickly jump to the thought of ideology because just by nature of your being a part of the Bush administration, who was the vice president of Reagan, who had a guy on their staff, Lee Atwater, who went out and did some of the things that he confessed to doing later on,
right.
people would automatically think that you're not committed to your own people mm-hmm. because you're with them.
Yeah. Yeah, and nothing could be further from the truth, because my commitment has been, and still is,
yeah.
to work to improve the health of all Americans, but particularly black Americans. And that really has meant working to increase the number of black health professionals, when I was secretary, doing a number of things to address needs in the black community. And also, I can tell you that while we got a lot of support from members of Congress who would Democrats, we got a hell of a lot from people who are Republican. Al Inspector is one of my heroes.
Yeah.
He was very good. Mark Hatfield,
mm-hmm.
also. So Silvio Conti, congressman from Western Massachusetts, Republican. So really,
yeah.
These are people I could work with and who really were very helpful to me.
Andy Young states in his foreword that you changed the national mindset about health care, especially when it came to women and minorities.
Well, when I came up for that talk with President-elect Bush in November of 88, and he said he wanted me to serve as a secretary, I then had a conversation. I had a little time to think about this.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, now I'm honored, et cetera, but these are the things that are important to me. These are the things I would want to really push very hard. I said, get more women and more minorities in positions, senior positions in the department, to focus resources on programs. And he said, Lou, fine, I support you on that. So when I accepted and came in, I knew I had his support.
Mm-hmm.
And I used that. The first woman to head NIH, Dr. Bernadine Healy,
yeah.
I recommended for appointment.
Mm-hmm.
The first female Surgeon General, Antonio Novello, also the first Hispanic. The first black woman to head Social Security, Gwendolyn King. The first black to head the Healthcare Financing Administration, now CMS, Bill Tobey. So we worked very hard to change the culture of that department and its diversity, both in terms of race and ethnicity and gender. I was not there to simply be a figurehead, but to really work to accomplish things.
And what that entire experience, is it something out of it in particular that was you found most rewarding during that time of high office?
Yes. First of all, I tremendously enjoyed working with the employees in the department, because I was impressed when I got there that rather than the picture that sometimes members of Congress give about people in the bureaucracy, these are very talented, dedicated, hardworking people. And I admired them and I respected them for that. And I told them when I went there, you know the issues better than I do. I'm new to government. And I need your help, and I want to work with you, and I want your ideas. In other words, I did everything I could to encourage them to come forward. And we've worked and developed a very good relationship with people in the department. And I found I was tremendously helped by briefings, both briefing books and meetings with members of the department, explain the issues we would debate, and I would make a decision. And sometimes that decision might be different from what they had recommended. But we'd had a healthy debate, and at other times, I would go with their recommendation. So in other words, I was saying, what is the best idea? Mm-hmm. You know, there's no pride of ownership here. Yeah. What we want to do is come out with what works so that we could be of the greatest service to the American people. So they understood that I was there for that, so I got a lot of help from them. So that was a tremendous experience.
You have a chapter towards the end, it's called Missing Persons. Tell us about that.
Yes. Well, that was a report of a commission that I chaired that the Kellogg Foundation funded in 2003 and 2004, where we were looking at the fact that efforts to improve increased diversity in the health professions had started in the late 60s, again, because of the civil rights activities. And we had made some progress, but we hadn't made as much as we thought we should have or could have. So that commission, which had among its members, for example, Congressman Stokes and some other very good people. We had Bob Dole, a Republican, and Paul Rogers, former Democratic congressman from Florida, as honorary co-chairs for this commission. We reported that while we had made progress, we'd fallen far short, and we needed to renew those efforts. And it came out with 37 specific recommendations. Such as changing the environment within health profession schools to be less competitive and more collaborative and more cooperative, increasing financial support for students, improving counseling of high school students. Many students really don't know what it takes to become a health professional, or even what are the various health professionals out there, not only medicine and dentistry, but physician's assistants, radio technology, et cetera. So we had all those recommendations saying we need to have people throughout the health professions, because we're changing as a nation. Mm-hmm. One third of Americans now are either Latino, African American, or Native American. Yeah. By the year 2042, we'll no longer have a majority population. Mm-hmm. So what we're saying is to address the health needs of all of our citizens, we need to have more diversity, because health care is influenced by not only by the knowledge of the health professional, but by that health professional's ability to connect with the patient, to understand the language, the customs, to generate trust so that the patient really feels comfortable, will follow directions, will come back for a follow-up visit. So that's why we need to have diversity to help us, as I say, in delivering the services that we should be delivering to the American people.
You know, let me say something. Unabashedly, I love this book. It's called Breaking Ground, My Life in Medicine by Dr. Lewis W. Sullivan. I am certainly going to make sure that those in my sphere of influence get a chance to read, to look at this book. And I know that they will be inspired by it. As you thought about writing this book, we have 2 minutes remaining. What is it that you want the reader to get from it?
What I hope that they will get from it is this. I came from relatively humble circumstances, and my father was broke when I was born. Mm-hmm. But because of his determination and the model that he set, I was determined, inspired by him and many others along the way, like Dr. Griffin, Dr. Mays, and others, to really work to really be the best doctor I could, and to have as much influence as I could. I hadn't planned to become Secretary of Health and Human Services, yeah, let alone Dean of a medical school. Yeah. But that really was the philosophy that Benjamin May said.
Yes.
He said, chance favors the prepared mind.
Yeah.
The opportunity came, yeah, And so I was prepared to go to Morehouse and start the medical school. Again, the opportunity to be secretary came. I would like to say I had planned that, but that would not be the case, that those happened. And so I was able to take advantage of that opportunity.
Dr. Sullivan, you are a great man and a great institution. You do us well, you do the country, you do the world well. Thank you so much for coming here today.
Well, thank you, I've enjoyed it very much.
God bless
thank
you.
Thank you.
Folks, that wraps us for today. For programs like this and any other, go to WHUT.org. I'm Rock Newman, God bless you, and I will see you the next time.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.